139. Isn't it good to be in God's house after being out for last Sunday for snow? Hard to believe we had 8 inches of snow last Sunday, and now we've got a beautiful day. Good day to be in God's house. Amen. Every day is a good day to be in God's house. Let's stand together. Let's sing this song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Wonderful song. God is faithful.
Blessing to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I don't take it for granted after last week. I sure did miss being here with you guys, but I appreciate everybody being here, visitors and members alike. And we're looking forward to seeing what God's going to do this morning for us. We're going to hear from the choir, but I'm going to ask Brother Gerald. It's been a while since I've seen you, brother. You're looking a little bit thinner, a little bit healthier now. I'm going to ask you to pray for us, brother, and ask the Lord, see what He'd let us, see if He'd bless us this morning.
Yes.
Comes down, stand with me and turn to 327. You know, he shed his blood for you and for me and for the whole world on the old rugged cross. All the songs I've chosen for the service this morning, the congregational songs that is, were actually songs that were used for Sister Jackie Wall's funeral that we attended, or her memorial service that we attended on Friday evening. And it was a very sweet, sweet service. I'm ordering a copy of it. They recorded it. I'm ordering a copy. If anybody wants a copy, let me know. Those of you that knew Sister Jackie and Brother Wilson, you know, he interned here as our pastor for 10 months while we were looking for a pastor, and knitted his hearts to ours. And of course, we loved him before then, but loved him even more through that process. And then here in the service, you know, you feel like you know someone, but I heard so many beautiful things from her children during that service that just endeared my heart to Sister Jackie. And I look forward to seeing her again in heaven. You know, she's not suffering. She's not feeling any pain. Right. Lived a good, fruitful life. Ministered to a lot of people. And so Wilson, his words were, you know, we sorrow not as those that have no hope. And we know we will see her again. Stand with me. Let's sing this song, The Old Rugged Cross. And think about Sister Jackie as we sing this morning. And our Lord.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross, where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross that he saved us someday for a crown. Oh, the old rugged cross, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear the grief of Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Let's sing that third stanza.
In the old rugged cross, stained with blood so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. What was on that old cross, Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. Cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down.
Most of us know the cross. Most of us believe in the cross, but I don't know if many of us cherish the cross. And I want to cherish the cross. A few things to make mention of. Let's do remember this evening, 6 o'clock. And let's do remember men's Bible study, January 26, 7:15. We have some books here. I have some more in my office. I have some more in the building. So if you signed up for a book, don't forget that. And then please don't forget the Valentine's Banquet, February 18th. We need as many people to sign up that's coming. Let us know. And I've been told that you have to give your money to Candy. And so we need to get that taken care of as soon as possible. But let's don't forget those things. And I do want to make mention, let's don't forget to continue to pray for Max. He was going to try to be here this morning, but he's not here this morning. And I just want to make mention of that. I'm going to ask Brother James if you'll pray over the tithe and offering this morning.
Our Father, we come before you this morning with our tithes and our offerings. We pray that you'll accept them and to be well pleasing unto thee. Pray that you'll bless them for the giving out of the gospel. Just be a blessing, Lord, to one another. As these things with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus, than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than men's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Amen. Thank you, Sarah. You know, sometimes the best songs are the ones with the least planning. And that song she decided to sing, I asked her what she sang this morning. She decided just before the service started, and I appreciate her willingness to sing for the church and sing for the Lord this morning. It's good to see some people here I hadn't seen in a while. I saw Junie and Ann Jackson just a little while ago. Good morning. Good to see you folks again. And there's many more I could call out, and I don't mean to embarrass you. I just wanted to say good morning. I love you. It's good to see you again. Take your hymn book and turn to 780. I'm sorry, 781. It's right across the page. I just looked at the wrong one. Face to face, I shall behold you. I think it was. Her family that sang this. We can all stand. You can go ahead and stand with me. Some of the family that sang this at the funeral. And it was a sweet, sweet spirit there, and I just wish all of you could have been there. I know it's a long way to travel, and he certainly didn't expect any of us to come. He was surprised, actually, that we were there. And I'll confess, we made it I'm not saying I wouldn't have went without another reason, but we had other reasons to go sort of that way. Went to Greenville first and then went up there. It's only about an hour from Greenville. But I'm so glad that I was able to be there, and that I can relay some of what was going on in that service. And I hope and pray that you will keep Wilson in your prayers. It's tough for him. He is very feeble now. And many of you know the last time maybe you saw him, he was stooped. Well, he's stooped even more, and he has to walk with a walker. And he's not going to be able to live alone. And a lot of things are going to change in his life. And not the least, not having someone by his side that was with him for 64 years. And I hurt for him. I was like, it's got to be hard. Some of you can identify with that. You've already lost mates. You know how that is. But keep him in your prayers. Send him a card. Let him know you love him. That'll mean a lot to him. Face to face, shall we say.
Face with Christ my Savior, face to face, what will it be? When with rapture I behold Him, Jesus Christ who died for me, face to face I shall behold Him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all His glory, I shall see Him by and by. Only faintly now I see Him, with the darkling veil between. But a blessed day is coming, amen, when His glory shall. Shall behold Him far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all His glory, I shall see Him by and by. On the last, face to face, oh blissful moment, face to face to see and know. Face I shall behold Him, far beyond the starry sky. Face to face in all His glory,
Amen. You may be seated.
All right. All the children. That's right. All the children free to go that are going to children's church. Ephesians chapter number 2, as we continue in our look at this passage. I do want to make mention of Brother Wall as well. I spoke to Brother Wall on Friday, and I've personally never met Brother Wall. I know he's prayed for me. I know he's been praying for me. I know he'll continue to pray for me. And we're going to continue to pray for him. He told me he tried to join the services by YouTube. I don't know if he's there now or not. It seemed the Lord had been gracious to him, at least the moment I had been speaking with him. But I can't imagine what he's probably feeling right now. Waking up this morning without his wife. It's interesting to point out. I'll say this. I was thinking about this the other day. Eve sinned before Adam sinned. And we know that Adam took the fruit because of Eve. But I wonder if we've ever thought about the fact that at the moment in time Eve sinned, God could have killed Eve and took Eve out and made another woman. Without a shadow of a doubt, he could have done that and continued with his plan with Adam. But Jesus said, what God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. And so God had created a family. At that point in time, he put those two people together. And God could have ended it. God had the right, righteous as he is. And I can't imagine what it feels like to have your flesh torn from you like that. It must be absolutely excruciating to know what he's going through. I can't imagine it. And I don't really want to imagine. I often joke with my wife that she'll leave before I do. But I really don't know if I could handle it. I just don't. Especially after 60-something years. But we're going to continue to pray for Brother Wall. Matter of fact, not this evening, but next Sunday evening, we're going to take up an offering for Brother Wall. He played an important part at this church. And it would be disrespectful as a church body not to do something for him. I know he's requested that money be sent to the wilds, but we're just going to do it anyways. And we want to let him know we love him, that we appreciate him. I'm sure he's incurred cost, and he needs it. And we can do that. I'm going to set aside, but I wanted you to know so that you could be preparing and be ready for that. But we're going to pray for him. We're not dropping him anytime soon. We're just going to keep supporting him. And that's our plan, and we love him. And if he's watching, we want him to know we love him. He seemed to indicate that he tries to join the services. And you really don't know who's watching right now. I mean, we really don't. We don't know the effect of the people who are joining us, who download the sermons online, who may watch on YouTube. We just don't know who's watching, what they may be going through. I don't know who God's going to bring in every Sunday. And that's why I don't get my messages from a book. I get my messages from God. And I don't know who's joining us online. I don't know what they're going through in their heart. I don't know how God's going to design it and how God works it all out. So we leave these things up to God. And God put this message into my heart, Ephesians chapter number 2, talking about his workmanship. And last week, really not last week, the week before last, we dealt with that plucking out. And we'll go over all that again. And this week we're going to talk about that passing, and then next week we're going to talk about the preparation. And I want us to look at this, and I want us to examine it, because we tend to look at a verse, and we tend to pull verses out. And we pull a verse out, and we can apply it to our lives and our circumstances, and that's fine. I've done it. That works, and it's great, and we can do that, and there's no harm. But when we take the Scriptures, and we apply the Scriptures as a whole, and we look at it and we pull it out, not as a little kernel, but as the whole corn on the cob. And we see that whole picture. We see that whole landscape. We see what God has really designed. And we see how we get from verse number 1 all the way to verse number 22. This whole chapter fits together. And I want us to see this. Verse number 1 says, "And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin, where in time past ye walked, according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past,
in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, whereby the nature of the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for His great love wherewith He loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you're saved, and hath raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come He might shew the exceeding riches of His grace and kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved, through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at the time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. For He is our peace, who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in His flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in Himself of twain one new man, so making peace, and that He might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, and came and preached peace to you which were far off and to them that were nigh. For through Him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens and the saints of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto a holy temple in the Lord, in whom ye also are builded together for an inhabitation of God through the Spirit. And so we're concentrating on verse number 10, where it says, "For we are His workmanship." And we talked about last time how this means that we are literally, now when it says His workmanship, this means the workmanship of God through Christ Jesus. And we talked about how that workmanship many times applies to someone taking their literal hands and their literal time and their life and their sweat and blood and tears and making something really out of nothing. And I many times like to look at, I like to watch people take steel and iron, and you watch a blacksmith use a tool and make something. To me, I love that. I absolutely love it. I like to watch someone take glass and take an old method of hand blowing glass and making it into beautiful pieces of art. We could apply this back to Jeremiah, where the potter and the clay, and we would do it no harm at all. And we see these things, and we see how we have been changed, the Bible says. We are His workmanship. Our problem is that we think that we go from verse number 1, where it says that we have been quickened, we have passed from death into life, we are new creatures, the Bible says. We think that we go from verse number 1 to verse number 10 instantly, to where we are His workmanship. We think it's just like that. We think we say a prayer, and then all of a sudden, physically, literally, we're changed. Now, I know that there's been a change on the inside. We're going to talk about that this morning. There's been a change on the inside. There'll be a change on the outside. And this is all through the work of Jesus Christ. But I believe that our Christian life is far more than a prayer and an occasional church attendance on Sunday or maybe even Wednesday. Christian life is a lot more than that. And I would go even as far to say that much of the New Testament is written to those who have fully given their life over to God. I would go as far to say that the promises that we read, the confirmations that we see from God, are not from those who are doing it half-hearted, but for those who have completely given everything over to God. We've made a lot to do about Brother Wall and Sister Wall this morning, a couple who had given their life over to God. And now this morning, I can't imagine what it was like for Sister Wall to close her eyes here and to open them into glory and see Jesus Christ. We just talked about that old rugged cross where we cherish it so much that we cannot wait until we get to that point to where we can lay all of our trophies down. The problem is we all expect to have trophies. We all think that we cherish the cross. But I imagine that when we get to heaven, there's going to be a lot less trophies laid down than we thought there was going to be. Because we live our lives thinking that we go from verse number 1 to verse number 10, and there's no proof, there's no dedication, there's no life given over to God. And you see that it says that we are His workmanship through Christ Jesus unto good works. And see, it doesn't just start. Last week we dealt with that plucking. And this week we'll deal with that passing, how we're new. And then next week we're going to deal with the preparation. And it all fits together. A whole life given over to God. You see, God didn't save us for us just to sit on the pews. He didn't. God saved us because He has a plan for every man, every woman, every boy, every girl. Doesn't matter how old they are. He has a plan, a design for their life. Sometimes we think we have a better design. We go against it. We think, and we're going to deal a lot with that next week. But last week we dealt with that plucking. And I want to look at it in the mindset of, as I said, as a blacksmith uses to make a tool or to make a weapon. And I got to thinking about that iron ore. And I have in my hand, of course, we dealt with this last week, a piece of iron ore. And the iron ore, we know that it's unseemly. It has no capability of getting itself out. We know that the Bible says, wherefore by sin entered into this world by one man. So death passed upon all for all of sin. We know, without a shadow of a doubt, let's just go through the facts that Jesus Christ, the Bible says that we've all sinned. But what happened? How did we get to this sin? Well, we all know that Adam took part of the fruit. And when Adam took the fruit, the Bible says, God looks at Adam and says in the Garden of Eden, He says, Adam, don't take that fruit. You can have every other tree in the garden, anything that you want, but don't take that fruit, that one fruit. And He told him, He said, when you do, you will die. That's what God said. Now, Adam is caused to fall in a deep sleep. God makes Eve. We know the story. Eve is in the garden, tending to the garden. The serpent comes and beguiles Eve. Eve takes the fruit. The Bible says that then Adam takes the fruit. Eve looks at Satan and says, God said that we're going to die when we take this fruit. Satan looks at her and says, you're not going to really die. And this is kind of the lie of Satan even today. You see, because when they bit into the fruit, they died. Yes, they begin to die physically. You see, from the moment you're born, you begin to die. That's the process that starts. You're on the road to death. But there's something even darker, even more heinous inside ourselves. And that's the fact that inside us there's a spirit, a soul. And when we're born, that spirit or soul is born with us dead. You see, that's the death that God told Adam and Eve they would experience, a spiritual death, a separation from God for all eternity. And the Bible says that without the remission of sin, without the shedding of blood, we can't get over this. Without the shedding of the blood, we can't be made alive. Paul says here to this church, he says, you have been quickened from death unto life. And we see, what is that talking about? You see, because when I got saved, I wasn't physically dead. I wasn't. When you got saved, you weren't physically dead. You had a heartbeat. You had brain activity. You had oxygen going through your lungs. You were alive. So what is that talking about? It's talking about that passing from spiritual life unto spiritual death. Now, we know that just as the iron ore has no ability to get itself out, we have no ability to get ourselves up. The Bible says that our righteousness is as filthy rags. And I don't know if we really think about that. We were spent some time yesterday with a gentleman who's done all kind of good things in his life for people. He's helped them get on their feet. He's done all kind of great things. And I believe the Lord's blessed him. But I began to think about all these good things. You see, we go through our lives and we think, well, I can do this or I can do that. And you see, most people don't think they look like that as a piece of iron ore. Most people think they look like this. See, this is the same piece of material. It's just had all the edges knocked off. You see, this piece is representative of people who have knocked all their edges off and have tried to do good things and who have tried to serve God without knowing God. And so we go through all these things, and I compare it many times to this. I compare it to maybe taking my youngest daughter. She loves to color. She loves to draw. All my children do. And I take it to maybe giving her a set of paint and paintbrushes and giving her a canvas and telling her to paint a picture. And I look at that picture as a father and I'd say, that picture is absolutely beautiful, babe. I'd even go as far to probably even put it up in my house just because she drew it, because I have a certain amount of love for it. And you may look at it and you may say, oh, she did a great job. For a six-year-old, she did a wonderful job. But now if we took this picture and we put it up beside a Picasso or a Michelangelo or something of that nature, something that we revere as being beautiful works of art, we'd look at it and we'd say, it just doesn't compare. There's no comparison. It's good. It's nice. It's wonderful. It may soothe my conscience to look at it. But at the end of the day, when compared to it, it would be absolutely no comparison. And that's what the Bible's talking about when it talks about our righteousness, our good deeds, all those things that we think are good about us. All those things. You see, I believe we have churches full of people like this that are living off of good deeds, that have had all the edges knocked off, that look good. They come into church every Sunday. They're there for all the services. But they're trusting in their own righteousness. There's never been a change. And here's what we have, is a church full of people sitting that have never had a change. And what God says is that all your good deeds, all those things that you've ever done, when compared to me, they're putrid, they're vile, and they're filthy rags. And that's what he says. And that's where we're at in reality before Jesus Christ. Now, where we're at before Jesus Christ is important because Jesus came. The Bible says that he was equal to God, but thought it not robbery. He came in the form of a servant, in the form of a man, the Bible says, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And so we can't pull ourselves out. We can't do anything. For by grace are you saved, that not of yourselves. That's what the Bible says. It says that we can't do it. So Jesus came. He took upon himself the flesh of man, died on the cross, took my sins, took your sins, died for every sin that had ever been committed all throughout history, all so that we could be changed. You see, because when we get saved, there's something that happens on the inside. And see, I'm going somewhere with this because at one point in time, see, mankind used to use iron, and we still use iron a lot for a lot of things, but iron has its weaknesses. Iron has a lot of problems. But at one point in time, a gentleman decided, you know what, I'm going to change the way we do things with iron. And he said, I'm going to add carbon to it. And when he added carbon to it, he got steel. Steel. Now this is a more superior piece of metal. This actually, this is a mineral, and this is an alloy. Two completely different things. You know, it's interesting to point out that you can always get steel from iron, but steel can never be turned back into iron. And we can always be changed into new creatures, but in reality, we can never go back to what we were. But there's been a change. You see, on the inside of steel, there's been a molecular change that changes the whole complex of this metal. Everything about it on the inside changes. Every single particle on the inside, when mixed with carbon, changes to steel. And I got to thinking about that and how this workmanship and how this applies. And I got to thinking about that internal change when added with the blood of Jesus Christ. There's an internal change within our lives. There's an internal change that takes place. There's something that happens inside me when I got saved that I cannot doubt it, that it changed me completely on the inside. And I'd venture to say that if you've never had a change on the inside, then you've never been saved. You see, a lot of people go from this, where they're in church, they're good, they're fine, they tithe, they try to serve God before they get saved, and then they get saved, and you say, well, there's not really been much of a change on the outside. And I understand that. And a lot of people say, well, I wonder if I really got saved because a lot didn't change on the outside. But I can guarantee you, the day you get saved, there's going to be an internal change that will change the rest of your life. I'm not talking about a change that takes place for a week or a change that takes place for a month or maybe even a change that takes place for a year. I mean a change that takes place for the rest of your life. The Bible says we have been made new creatures. All things have passed away. Behold, all things are made new. The Bible says all things. We have been changed internally. You see, I have a soul. You have a soul. That is what's going to live on when you die. And the truth is here is that if you've been saved, your soul has passed from death unto life. And I don't know if there's a lot of people sitting on church pews that have never really had an internal change. Something inside that has literally changed within you. I remember what I was like before I got saved. I remember the inner rebellion. I remember all those things that I dealt with. But I remember the day that I was sitting in that church service and the preacher began preaching about hell and getting saved. And I remember going down. I didn't go into any kind of magical booth. He didn't take a magical wand. All I did is went down to the altar. I remember I went down to the left side, far corner of that building. And he came to me and he said, well, what do you need? He thought maybe, you know, he needed to talk to me a little bit. I knew. You see, when God's dealing with you, you don't need to be talked to. You know exactly what you need. And I knew exactly what I needed. I looked at him and said, well, I just need to get saved. He said, well, you want to talk? I didn't need to talk. I didn't need to discuss. I didn't need to go into a room for 30 minutes and discuss all the different principles of the Bible. I knew I needed one thing, and that was Jesus. Jesus Christ. I remember getting down. I remember praying. I didn't shed a tear. I didn't cry. I didn't experience any kind of charismatic mumbo jumbo. None of that. All I remember is getting up and there being a complete and different change inside. And there must be a change on the inside. But more importantly than a change on the inside, there has to be. If you've never had a change on the inside, you've never been saved. And I can show you in the Bible that you've never been saved. But what happens after you have a change on the inside? You see, this steel ball changes on the inside. Now, this steel ball is shiny because it's had chromium added to it. I like shiny chrome. Brother Sammy's got nice cars. We used to go to the drag show. They say chrome won't get you home, but it looks nice sitting in the driveway. But this has had chromium added to it, so it shines a little bit better. But there's been a complete change because of what's changed on the inside of steel. The outside is changed as well. And I think we forget about this a lot of times. We think a lot of times, well, I'm saved. I've got liberties. I can do what I want. And I think modern Christianity has lied to us. I really do. Modern Christianity tells us that we need to fit in, that we don't need to judge, that we don't need to tell them that sin is wrong, that we don't need to tell them that the Word of God is right. Modern Christianity has got us two sodomites, women, pastoring churches in Washington, D.C., in a Baptist church. That's what modern Christianity's got us. They say just be cool, just be accepting, just let them have whatever they want. Let them in and let them do this and let them do that. But I can go out on a limb and say this, that if you've ever been changed, not only is there going to be a change on the inside, you're going to change on the inside, but you're going to change on the outside. Without a shadow of a doubt, if you take a flashlight and you cover up with a paper cup, you're going to see the light coming out from underneath that cup. And just like that, there's been a light that is illuminated inside our souls. And it ought to be coming out on the outside. You know what keeps it from coming out on the outside? Sin. Covering it up with sin. Covering our lives up with sin keeps it from showing what's on the inside on the outside. And there must be a change on the inside. Now, I'm not going to sit here and I don't follow you around and I'm not going to come behind you with a police siren every time I see you doing something that I don't think's right. I'm telling you what, but we need to get in the Bible. We need to spend some more time in the Bible. We need to spend some more time in God's Word. Because God clearly states that what's changed on the inside must come out of the outside. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. I mean, it's a simple principle. What's on the inside will come out on the outside. And if you don't have any change on the outside, then you've never had a change on the inside. That's the truth. That's where we're at. There must be a change. And see, this is all going to flow because we don't get from verse number 1 to verse number 10 without seeing some changes, without seeing some lives change, without seeing some personalities change, without seeing some the way we dress, the way we speak, the things we do. I mean, that's just the... here we are. We've been saved. Something has happened on the inside. And now we're supposed to live the outside the exact same way, even though we know that the Holy Spirit is living inside us. What communion hath light with darkness? That's what the Word of God says. How can two walk together lest they be agreed? What the Bible says. And how can I live over here on the inside like I'm righteous, like I've got God on the inside, and walk over here like I'm living like the world on the outside? It won't happen. It won't. That won't walk together. The Bible says that they won't walk together because they don't agree. And my inside life, my outside life, ought to get together somewhere in that middle and reflect Jesus Christ. And unless I'm doing that, something is wrong on the inside. And that's the truth of the Word of God. There has been a change that's taken place. And if you've never had a change, you see, this is where most people really are. We've knocked all the edges off. Easy believism. There's been a lot going around of that for the last 30 years. Get you in a little room, say a little prayer, put your name on the roll, throw you through the water, and you're done. And there's never been a change on the inside. No conviction, no conversion. You see, what do we talk about that plucking? Someone had to come and pluck me out. The Bible says no man comes to the Father but by me. Bible talks about how no man can come to Jesus unless God draws him. And I believe that God's going to draw people. And I believe that when God draws people and God saves people, that God changes people. And if there's never been... I'm telling you, that was the same preaching that was happening 60, 80, 100, 200 years ago. And somehow somebody let go of that ball and it's just gone somewhere else. And we got all this happy preaching going on now. And the truth is that we're losing our children, we're losing our families, because we won't preach that there has to be a change on the inside and the outside. Because God has a work, a good work, over here for us to do. But God's not going to use anybody that's not willing to walk according to the Scriptures of His Word. Fully being committed over to God. And here's what it comes down to, is that we don't cherish Him like we should. I mean, that's just the honest truth. He saved. Do you really know where you were at? Do you really remember where you were heading? Because I remember the night that I got saved, it was so real that I couldn't get over it. And so what happens is we get over here and we get under conviction and we get saved. And we feel the real heat of hell and the love of God and the mercy of God. And we get saved. A week later, we're still saved, but that feeling, that heat and feeling where we were at and knowing where we were going is gone. We get a year later, and it's even farther gone. We get 10 years down the road, 20 years down the road, 30 years down the road. We're just as much saved as we were over there. But for some reason, we've forgotten where we were going and why we were going there. And so we begin to let up on some things. And we begin to just skirt some things because we say, well, we have liberties. You know what Paul says? Paul says, you have liberties, yes, but don't let your liberties be a stumbling block to somebody else. That's what Paul says. And I just want us to recognize that this is a process that we've got to follow through if we ever want to be used by God. Because that's the ultimate goal, right? I mean, we sit in here today and we say, well, we really want God to use us. Do you really? If you really do, here's the process that follows. You get saved, you give your life over to God, and you change everything about you and you follow. That's what He said. Forsake everything you have. That's what He did. He looked at His disciples, said, forsake everything and follow me. He says, if you'll lose home and land and father and mother, He says, you'll be surprised what I'm going to give you later on. I mean, it's only temporary. Let's face it. I mean, it's nice to have nice things here, but one day, one day we're going to be like Sister Wall, and we're going to walk into heaven, and none of those things are even going to matter anymore. Not a one of them. Not a nice car, not a big house, not a good job. The only thing that's going to matter is, where's Jesus? I got to get to His feet. And this is where we're at, this process of getting unto good works. And there's been an internal change and an external change, but because there's been an internal change and an external change, and I'll run through these really quick, there's some things, some attributes that still has that iron does not have. A few different things. Number one, I always want to point out, is that steel contains traces of iron in it. And I want to point out that no matter how far we go, no matter where we go, no matter how far we think we get with God, we've still got that old man within us. And that old man's fighting us every single day. And it's a battle, and we're going to talk a little bit about that tonight, but it is a battle. I know it's a battle. I live in the same flesh. I'm not a robot. I'm not any kind of... God didn't give me any kind of holy medicine to make me not have to battle sin like you did. I know it's a battle. You're going to fight it every day, and within you is that old man. And you've heard that saying, whichever man you feed is the one that's going to grow. And that's the truth. I don't know if you've ever thought, who are you feeding every day when you get up? What are you looking at? It used to be, people would say, well, do you grab the newspaper first or your Bible? But now it's, do you turn on the television or, I've got all kind of electronic devices. Do I turn on the iPad and look at the news, or do I turn on my phone, read the emails? Or do I grab that Bible? Do I feed him first? Do I feed that spiritual man first? Because if I don't, that old man's going to get stronger and stronger and stronger. And this is why, and we're going to deal with this here in a second, but this is why we have so many people that seem to come and then you can't find them 10 years down the road. Because you know what happened? Over here, they fed that old man one day instead of feeding the new man. And then the old man said, you know what, I want a little bit more. Because it's interesting that the old man, that old saying, the squeaky wheel gets the oil, the old man's a little bit more squeakier than the new man, it seems like. It seems like we like to feed that old man a little bit, and then the new man gets quieter and quieter, and the old man gets louder and louder, and then before we know it, we're just not even walking with God anymore. And there's still the new man within us, but that old man is as strong as he's ever been. Paul said, those things that I want to do, I don't do, and the things that I don't want to do, I do. This is where Paul's at. This is Paul, the Apostle Paul, the great Christian warrior, saying, I can't help but sin. And so we contain traces of our old man. Steel is stronger than iron due to its internal chains. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. You know, we live in a crazy world. Absolutely crazy world. We're going to go through all kinds of things. I think of Brother Wall. I think of Brother Max here going through what he's going through. We don't know what you're going to wake up with tomorrow. You don't. You wake up tomorrow and your world could be completely turned upside down. My world could be completely turned upside down tomorrow. And Jesus Christ says that greater is He that's in you. We have a strength within us. We have a strength within us. See, we like to think that it's all us. We like to think that we've done this. We like to think that we boast of ourselves. The Bible says, not of works, lest any man should boast. But for some reason, we like to boast of ourselves. And we like to think we've done it ourselves, but we have to remember that we could have never been changed without the blood of Jesus Christ. And see, within ourselves, we have nothing. All we are, and this is where we're going to get to, all we are tools in the hand of God. And this is where the process is going to get to. But right here, this is where we're at. And so we see steel is stronger, steel is denser. Due to an internal change, steel is always going to be denser than iron. And the way I want to point this out is that the Bible talks about how we can make an impact on this world. Now, I understand there have been men who have been lost that have made great, great impacts on this world. But there have been men who have died in the world's eyes who have never made an impact on this world but have made such an impact in heaven. I believe Brother James, I think he said something We influenced so many people's lives within our lifetime. I can't remember how it was a humongous number. We were talking about this yesterday and how the effects, we like to refer to it as the ripple effect. You throw a stone in a pond, and the bigger the stone, the bigger the ripple. And the business world, they like to use this and say that they want to make a ripple in the business world. But I'm telling you what, there's going to be some eternal ripples that are going to go on. And I think of men like Charles Haddon Spurgeon. And the truth is, when Charles Haddon Spurgeon died, it shut down London. They all came to his funeral. A man who made not just an impact in this physical world, but made such an impact in the spiritual world, to the fact that today that a young man like myself can pick up one of his books and read it and get something out of it, and how much of an impact he's made. And I don't know if we really realize the impact that we're making every day. Every day we make. Brother Max, I'd said this the other day, that Max told me that the reason he left the church when he turned 18, he looked at me, he said, "My dad's a pastor. My dad's a preacher. Been preaching since I was, since before he was born." And he looked at me and he said, "I left at 18 because I couldn't stand the way that the church acted. And because of that action, he left and didn't get saved until 2006. And you think that you don't have an effect on somebody's life? You say, "Well, I'm just here. I'm just sitting on the pews." You will affect somebody's life whether you like it or not. And I don't know if we really understand how far that ripple goes out. Generation after generation after generation. Some of you in here have grandchildren. You fall out of church, you walk away from God. Your grandchildren are going to face the penalty for that. I have children. I walk away from God right now. If I turn my back on God and look my children in the face and tell them that everything that I've ever preached, everything that I've ever believed, everything that I've ever said was right is wrong, I'm going to probably, most likely, not just ruin their lives, I'll ruin my grandkids' lives. I'll ruin my great-grandkids' lives. It will be a ripple that will continue for all eternity. And I wonder if we won't have to stand before God and look God in the eyes, and He's going to say, "You see that person over there that's dying and going to hell? That's your fault. That's your decision that you made. That's yours." You see, because we as Christians are made up internally of something that's a little bit denser, something that's going to make a little bit more of an impact on this world than we think. See, we think there's not going to be any impact made. I wasn't able to go to the memorial service, but I imagine that memorial service was probably packed out. After that many years of serving God, after that many years of just serving God faithfully, and from what I've been told, serving God would really little to nothing. And yet, the world would look at Brother Wall and Sister Wall and say, "They didn't do anything in this world. They didn't amount to anything. They don't have anything to leave anybody. They don't matter at all to this world." But I guarantee you, when she walked into heaven, Jesus Christ stood up and saluted. Because that's the impact that a person who's in the hand of God... See, I'm trying not to jump ahead. Because I've been trying to jump ahead now for 3 weeks. You guys made me... We missed last week, and I almost came here and just preached it anyways. But we get in that hand of God, and you don't know the impact we can make. And so we see that it's denser. Not only is it stronger, not only is it denser, but steel, and this is actually interesting, steel is able to fight off rust better than iron. You see, iron, even this piece right here in its natural state, contains rust inside it. And it's rusty, it's got a little bit of rust on it. And iron cannot help but rust in its natural state. And see, in our natural states as sinners, we couldn't help but be affected by sin. We couldn't help but have the marks of sin all over our lives. But you see, when we've been changed, because we've had an internal change, the Bible says that we have victory over sin. The Bible says that we are victorious. The Bible says that we're more than overcomers. That's what the Bible says. But the important thing is to point out that we may be able to resist it, but you sit out in the world a little bit too long and you'll get covered in it. We're not impenetrable. We're just a little bit resistant to it. But it's not because of us. It's because of He that is in us. So I wonder sometimes if we've been changed, but a lot of times we'll say, well, you know what? God's given me liberty to go do this. I'm just going to get in the world just a little bit. I'm just going to do this. I'm going to do. I mean, this goes back to that modern Christianity. You see, modern Christianity has really, I mean, it has ruined us. It said that you can watch what the world watches. It's okay, as long as you don't say it, you can hear it. As long as you don't get drunk, you can drink it. As long as you don't, you know, commit some kind of crime, you can do whatever you want. Because God's given you liberties that He hasn't given somebody else. And the truth of the matter is all we're doing, like I said, is we're feeding the old man. We're over here watching what we want to watch. We're listening to what we want to watch. We're doing what we want to do. We're going where we want to go. And the world's looking at us and they're saying, see, this is the way the world, they're looking at those two sodomites that they just put in that church up there. They think it's a great thing because the church is finally coming around to what? To their level. I'm sorry, but I'll die before I go to the world's level. That's just the end. But the Bible says it's wrong, it's wrong. And we need to do everything we can to keep ourselves from rusting. Keep ourselves from getting into the world and being covered by this sin. And it's all because of the fact that there's been an internal change. Something has changed. Not only is it resistant to rust, but it reacts to fire differently. It reacts to fire more differently than iron does. It's more malleable to the fire. And we're going to get to this next week, and we're going to talk about this fire and this pressing and the squeezing and the preparation. But you're going to go through times. And I'm telling you what, you're going to feel like you don't understand why God is squeezing the life out of you. You're going to wake up and you're going to say, God, why are you squeezing me again? God, why are you squeezing me now? Why are you squeezing me now? I'd read it a couple weeks back, Oswald Chambers. I've been reading after him a little bit. He said that God only squeezes the fruit that's the ripest. And I never thought about that a little bit. But here we are, and we're going to go through some fire. The Bible says that we're going to, James says, not to think it's strange, we enter into diverse temptations. And here we are, and we're going to go through all these things. But the thing that's been added to us is going to allow us to react differently through the fire. When you squeeze an orange, you get orange juice. When you squeeze an apple, you get apple juice. When you squeeze a Christian, you should get Jesus. And that's where we should, I mean, really, when you get squeezed, what comes out? What comes out? It reacts to fire differently. And lastly, steel is more commonly used in the manufacturing of tools. You see, God will never use a lost man to get His work done. Now, God has used lost men to fund His work, but He will not use a lost man like He'll use a saved man. It's completely different work. And this is where we're going to get next week, when we're talking about these tools and in God's hands and the pressing and the preparation and how it's all done. But God has a plan for you. God has a specific plan for you. Something that He has designed for your life, that He hasn't designed for anybody else's life. You see, I can go, I have a problem. See, I see all these men. I think of men like Charles Haddon Spurgeon. I think of Lee Robinson. I think of Dr. Seidler. I think of Brother Chappell out on the West Coast. I think of Dr. Sexton. I think of all these men that have done great works. And see, I'm the kind of person that's like that child that just watched another child get an ice cream and say, God, why can't I have it? You know, I don't want His ministry, but I want His blessings. And I think about those things, and I understand that God has designed a ministry for them, just like He's designed the ministry here. But God has a plan. And God's going to mold you. If you allow Him, see, this is the thing. A lot of us are, like, we're changed, we've been saved, there's been an internal change, but we refuse to allow God to mold us into the tool that He desires to get the work done. And we're going to talk a little bit about it. I'm trying my best not to get ahead. It's really just burning inside. But God has a plan. But it all starts as us being worth nothing, getting plucked out by Jesus Christ, and having an internal change that changes our lives for our whole lives. It's not a week long. I mean, we just passed January 1st. Everybody gets on January 1st and they say, you know what, I'm going to eat better, I'm going to live better, I'm going to try to do better. And that lasts for about 2 weeks. And that's the way it goes. I guarantee you they sold a million different scales at the Walmart this past month. Everybody trying to get better. But here we have it. And we live our Christian lives the same way. We say, this week I'm going to live for God. We start a new year and we say, God, I'm going to give you everything I've got. God, I'm just going to give it over. And a week goes by and you say, well, God, you really don't need me. You've got all these other people. And we mistake God's liberties for the fact that He wants us to do something. He wants us to give our whole life over, every bit of our life, every decision we make. He didn't plan for us to live half in the world and half in the church. He wanted us to give everything over to Him. Every single bit. He changed us. Now it's up to us to decide whether or not we're going to live for Him. Please stand. I'm through preaching. Every head bowed and every eye closed. As they begin to play the music and the altar's open, I don't know what you have a need. Maybe you have a need. Maybe you've never been saved. Maybe you need to get saved. Maybe you've gotten away from God and you need to come down here and make it right. Because I can guarantee you, if God's dealt with you now, He may not deal with you again. Maybe you have something in your life that you need to take care of. I don't know what it is. But don't leave today without taking care of it. The altars are open. If you have a need, don't miss your opportunity.